and welcome to Ag PhD. I'm Brian Hefty.
And I'm Darren Hefty. Thanks for joining us today. One of the things that really grew in popularity this year as the soybean price came up was the demand for soybean fungicides. We'll talk about some of the different diseases, including white mold and others, and even plant health, how big a deal that is.
You already know about ALS weed resistance, you know about Roundup weed resistance, but today we want to talk a little about HPPDs and even PPOs. There are beginning to be some concerns with those chemistries as well. How are you going to kill weeds next year? We'll talk about it today.
Well, there are not very many chemistries that work on controlling our weed of the week. We'll talk about what can stop this tough weed later in the show, but first, here's our farm basics.
Farm Basics is brought to you by the Liberty Link Trait and Liberty Herbicide from Bayer. The most reliable weed management solution, Liberty Link and Liberty Herbicide are the link to efficient row crop production and sustainable weed management.
During our Farm Basics time today, we want to invite you to the Ag PhD Field Day. We're going to discuss what will be going on at the Field Day this year and why you need to join us.
We spend a lot of our time in the spring getting the Field Day site ready. There are so many different crops that we plant and new technologies that we've got to manage, new products, new fertilizers, new herbicides, all these things. It's really exciting for us and it's fun because it's on our farm, so we get to look at it all year long. And we thought, man, if we're doing all this stuff, we really need to show everybody else. So we invite you to come to our Field Day to see all the things that we're working on and all the new things that are coming in the ag industry. It's really exciting.
Well, that's really the big thing. When we talk about new technologies, new products, everybody is interested in all that stuff. But you know what? It's a lot more fun to look at it somewhere else than your own farm year one, because a lot of times there are new products that they simply don't work. So we'll talk about some of the good and the bad that's coming out in the future, how you can use those things on your farm and actually maximize your yield and maximize your profits.
All right. So what do Brian and I really think about some of these products? You can see it because we've got plots called the first step plots, where we're taking our first steps to ultra high yields and we're competing against some great farmers.
Well, hold up though, Darren. We aren't even competing as much as we're just working with a lot of great high yield farmers from around the country. So we've invited to our farm four of the best corn farmers in the whole world, four of the best soybean farmers, and four of the best wheat farmers, and they've got plots on our farm just like we do. So they're going to go through what they did for corn production or soybean production or wheat production. You'll get to hear those great farmers speak and see what they're actually doing in the fields.
Well, and it's cool because it's on our farm. It's, hey, here's the soils that we're facing. Now what do you do? And it may be different from what these guys are doing at home on their own farms because they've got a different climate, they've got different soils and all those things. And so learning and making those adjustments, really that's what farming is all about. If you want to change things on your farm, getting some new ideas is where it starts. The Ag PhD Field Day is a great spot for that.
So in addition to having these first steps plots, we do have a number of our research plots and new technology plots for you to look at. We've invited in a bunch of great guest speakers, including Tom Osborne, the legendary head coach from Nebraska. We've got Mike Golick from Mike and Mike in the Morning and ESPN Radio, and a number of others for topics like estate planning or drainage law and other things. So it'll be a great day, a lot of fun. You'll get a great meal, a lot of special things we've got for you planned that day as well. It's Thursday, July 28th on our farm near Baltic, South Dakota. We invite you to go to agphd.com to learn more.
And while you're at agphd.com, don't forget to pre-register. It will save you some time when you get to the Field Day, so you have more time to look around. Now, one of the things that we hope you don't see at the Field Day is our Weed of the Week. Can you identify this week's weed?
With new seed traits and chemistries entering the market, your crop protection equipment needs precision and adaptability. HiPro Innovative Spray Technologies has the products to give your applications greater accuracy, less drift, and more coverage. HiPro, right on technology, right on target.
Introducing the SoilMax ZD48, the newest addition to the SoilMax Gold Digger lineup. The first plow designed for smaller class tractors, the ZD48 has been tested on tractors weighing between 10,000 and 16,000 pounds with excellent results. Designed for row crop farms, vineyards, irrigation, and specialty crop farms. The SoilMax ZD48 will install tile up to 48 inches deep, as well as install 3 or 4 inch tile. The ZD48 truly opens up the world of tile installation to more farms than ever before.
Are you looking for an easy way to apply dry powdered products to your stored grain? Do you want to use the applicator recommended by industry leaders for products like Diacon D and other dry powder products? Changing Time CT applicators successfully apply a diversity of products quickly, easily, and accurately. The innovative CT applicators are designed to give you the most accurate application of products such as talc, inoculants, fertilizers, and other dry products. For commercial use or on the farm, you need the applicator industry leaders are using. CT applicators for the changing times.
Take a look inside any rotary combine and you'll find single rotor technology. Technology Case IH introduced over 35 years ago with the Axial Flow Combine. But unless it gives you more bells and whistles with fewer belts and chains, more power using less fuel, it's not an Axial Flow. Because while the heart of every rotary combine beats red, only Case IH gives you the power to do more.
Apply gypsoil on your farm to add cost-effective sulfur to soils and improve soil structure. Gypsoil increases calcium and helps flush excess magnesium in tight soils, improve air and water infiltration, and reduce problem wet spots and crusting. Better soil quality means better water quality, so gypsoil is good for the environment too. For more information about putting gypsoil to work on your farm, call 866-GYPSOIL or 497-7645. Visit online at gypsoil.com.
Technology is constantly changing the way we farm. HiPro Innovative Spray Technologies are here to keep your farm at the forefront of agricultural innovation. With spray application equipment for any scenario, HiPro is here to put you right on technology, right on target.
One of the things that's changed a lot in terms of soybean production in the United States is the use of fungicides versus, say, 10 or 15 years ago. 10 or 15 years ago, there was almost no fungicide used in soybeans. Today, most farmers are using fungicides, and on our own farm, we're going to use fungicide at least twice and maybe even three times, depending on how late season things kind of look, because we do get concerned about white mold really late season.
Well, there have been so many things that have changed in agriculture just in my lifetime. When you look at soybeans, how many more diseases that we're seeing there that we didn't really see before, and then also this big focus on plant health. That's really changed the game when you realize, you know what, we're aborting so many flowers. What can we do to keep that plant healthier and happier so we can hold on some more flowers? And just a small percentage gain in the amount of flowers held can be a big result in yield.
Here's the way I look at this whole thing. Everything is driven by economics. It's interesting how things have changed in terms of soybean production in the U.S. in the last 10 to 15 years. 10 to 15 years ago, almost no fungicide was used. Well, today, most soybean farmers are using fungicide, and like on our farm, we're going to use fungicide for sure two times and maybe even three times. Maybe the biggest factor that has entered into this whole thing is just the simple economics. The soybean price is dramatically higher than it was 10 or 15 years ago. Our yields are higher. And then the other thing is fungicide prices have crashed in the last 2 years. So you could go out literally for $3 an acre is all. So let's say you're out spraying insecticide and foliar fertilizer or something already, so you don't have to make another trip off across the field. You throw the fungicide in. A lot of guys are throwing in a half rate when the beans are small, and a lot of people are reporting pretty good success with that. Okay, well, $3, that's not much on $10 soybeans, for example, as opposed to 10 or 15 years ago when it was maybe $5 or $6 soybeans and a $10 cost or more for the fungicide.
Well, and you're talking upper Midwest, and you're also considering that we're not making a separate trip. We're putting it in at the same time that we're spraying insecticide
or, that's what I'm saying.
Or herbicide, those kinds of things. Yeah, so it's not, well, we've got to hire a plane now to do this because we can drive through
soybeans. Let's say we even had to spend the money on application. Okay, if we do our own application, we got $3 for application. We've got, even let's say we run full rate and we go $6 or $8. So call it $8 plus $3, that's $11. Well, if a bushel of soybeans is about that much, it's one bushel. So all we're asking for is a one bushel gain. That's it. Well, it's not much to gain one bushel. We've had tremendous gains in some cases. Most of the time, though, even in dry country, we're gaining a bushel and a half or two bushels. So if you could gain two bushels, you spent one, that's a pretty decent return on investment.
All right, now as you go further south from where we farm, obviously there's a lot more disease pressure when you get into more humidity, more rainfall, you know, all those things where you've got frog eye leaf spot and it's just a constant problem through the growing season. You get further south, you've got all kinds of different diseases. So certainly in those types of situations, varietal tolerance really plays a factor in this, just like it does in corn. Guys say, well, sometimes I get big response in corn and sometimes I don't. And you know what? You can go from one field to the next and different hybrids have different tolerances. It's the same thing in soybeans. You have to be very cautious as you're picking soybean varieties. Hey, what is the disease tolerance for the specific ones I've got in my area?
All right, so here's what we suggest you do. Number one, you're going to have a lot more disease pressure if you have the right weather. So what we're talking about is not drought conditions, basically. We want moisture and moderate temperatures, and that's where we have the most disease issues. Now, I'm not saying we want disease issues. I'm just saying that's when you can expect to get the greatest response from a fungicide. Now, yes, there are the plant health benefits, and that's always there, but the other side is disease. So I like spraying when I have better odds for success. So if it looks like you have the right weather conditions, if it looks like, hey, I've had a history of disease or there's disease in my general area, it's probably a good idea that you spray. But what are you going to spray? Well, if you've got a white mold issue, that's where Domark is much better. Or certainly you could go to Proline or Endura. They cost a lot more money. Domark's the less expensive option. Otherwise, you've got pretty much every option open to you, whether it's Preax or Stratego Yield, Quilt XL, Fortix. I mean, you name it, there are all kinds of fungicides out there.
And we get asked all the time, well, what's the difference between these fungicides? Is one way better than another? Like Brian said, white mold is one of those diseases that, yeah, you have to pick different fungicides for, yep. And we know which ones are better there. But when you're just saying, you know, just the assortment of diseases that might potentially be out there, we don't see a huge difference for the most part between many of these fungicides.
No, but we might like a two mode of action fungicide. I mean, that would be a little bit better, but it's going to cost a little more too.
Look at frog eye, the strobil urins or strobilurins. They just don't seem to work on frog eye anymore. We're seeing some resistance show up, especially along the Mississippi River in the Mid-South. So when you've got that kind of situation going, you want to use either a triazole or an SDHI or a combination that maybe you want that strobilurin in there to try to get the plant health benefits. And then you've got something else in there to stop the frog eye.
Well, once again, we strongly encourage you take a look at fungicides on your farm. When you're spraying early, a lot of people have had pretty good luck with half rate. Once the plant gets big, or if you're in a big disease area, then absolutely be using the full rate. But again, the good news is fungicide prices are way down from a couple of years ago, so you should be able to economically spray just about any fungicide on your farm.
And you might be able to add your fungicide to the tank as you're out spraying for our weed of the week. Can you identify this week's weed?
I would recommend Morton for many reasons, but one is that they have a long history of standing behind their buildings.
Our sales experience with Morton was a nice experience. You know, they told us what it was going to cost, what it was going to be, you know, how it was going to run, and it worked out really well for us.
Morton has built me one heck of a nice building, and it should stand for a very, very long time. I was very happy with the workmanship.
Check us out online at mortonbuildings.com.
I trust Agro Liquid because I've seen the results and they're positive and they work on my farm, they work in my environment. When I started farming, we was farming around 125 acres and now we're up to around 1,700 acres. I think I was recognized as the Tennessee Young Farmer by being a leader in the community and also being innovative. I'm always looking for new products, but I got to make sure that those products are sustainable. I've got a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old and I would love for them to farm this land.
When there's work to be done on your farm, you can't afford to be grounded. Whether for repair or upgrade, you need quality, new, used, and rebuilt parts fast. Worthington Ag Parts has what you need, and our distribution network offers same-day service to much of the country. And with 15% off all parts ordered in July, now's a great time to get to know us. Worthington Ag Parts, providing quality parts at quality prices and adding value to your farm operations for over 50 years.
Attention farmers, are you able to sell your grain for a premium? Your local AgriDry dealer can show you how farmers are seeing a return on their investment with AgriDry products this year. Higher test weights, even distribution of foreign material, and target moisture premiums are all benefits AgriDry customers are seeing on their grain sales tickets this year. Are you ready to start making more money on your stored grain? Visit agridryllc.com to find your local dealer today.
Introducing the SoilMax ZD48, the newest addition to the SoilMax Gold Digger lineup. The first plow designed for smaller class tractors, the ZD48 has been tested on tractors weighing between 10,000 and 16,000 pounds with excellent results. Designed for row crop farms, vineyards, irrigation, and specialty crop farms. The SoilMax ZD48 will install tile up to 48 inches deep, as well as install 3 or 4 inch tile. The ZD48 truly opens up the world of tile installation to more farms than ever before.
Over the last few years, we've talked an awful lot about weed resistance here at Ag PhD, but we haven't spent much time talking about potential PPO resistance and HPPD resistance. Well, I got a call just a few weeks ago from a farmer who'd used an HPPD down in corn, used an HPPD post, and guess what? His field was solid water hemp. I mean, solid water hemp. Now, we can't sit here and tell you, oh, there's lots of HPPD resistance, so there's lots of PPO resistance with water hemp across the country. But what we can tell you is we're very concerned about this when you use the same mode of action time and time and time again, you're bound to start having some issues eventually.
This isn't as simple as glyphosate resistance because, oh, okay, there's one product, Roundup, that I can't use anymore. When we talk about the HPPDs, there's quite a few different products, whether it's pre or post. Now, post, we're talking about things like Callisto, Laudis, Armazon, Impact, four main products. And now we're starting to see some generics as well. Then when we look at the pre's, there's a lot of these four products that we just talked about that are getting mixed into things like Halex, for example. And it's like,
or
wow,
also
there's
also Balance Flex. There's also Balance Flex. And so let's say you got a product like Corvus, for example, and the farmer that I was talking to happened to use Corvus. Well, what does Corvus have in it? It's got an ALS. We already know water hemp's resistant to the ALS family, and it's got Balance Flex and HPPD. Then he came post-emerge with Laudis. So he didn't mix things up at all. He used one chemistry, ALS, where we know we've already got a big time problem, and then he used HPPD, that's it.
And it feels like you're using different things because, wait, it's not Roundup and Roundup. I know I'm using the same thing, but wow, I didn't know they had some of that in there. That's why that's been working the way it has. So you really have to pay attention to what chemical families are in each thing that you're applying to make sure that you're getting some differences out there.
One of the things you can do is use our free app that we have, the MOA or Mode of Action app for your smartphone or your tablet. That's a good way to look at, okay, these are the products I want to use, these are the chemical families that I'm getting into.
All right, when you think about the PPOs, that's really scary to me, Brian. If there's resistance to PPOs, we don't have it yet on our farm, but there are certainly some areas in the
country
where
we're seeing
it.
Here's why I'm not that scared. Okay, by PPOs, we're talking about things like Valor or Authority in soybeans, but also we have the post-emerge products that could be used pre, like Flexstar, and then the straight post products, Cobra, Cadet, Resource. Yeah, we've got some issues out there if this is a problem, but here's the reason why I'm not that worried about it, because we do have other modes of action you can use pre. I don't know of a lot of resistance that we have with Metribuzin or a lot of resistance that we have with the yellows. So if you throw Metribuzin, a yellow, and a PPO out there, you've got two others, and
maybe,
then post-emerge, by next year, you should be able to use Dicamba and Dicamba beans, 2,4-D on the Enlist beans, and then we've got Balance beans coming as well. So we've got a number of different modes of action that we might be able to use in soybeans that we haven't been able to before.
All right, we happen to be standing right by a field of Enlist soybeans that we have sprayed Enlist Duo on, which is glyphosate plus the new 2,4-D choline, and it looks awesome. And you're right, when we get those other options out there, and we've got Xtend soybeans on our farm, and wow, does that herbicide solution look great. But in the meantime, we've got a big problem here because we're starting to see resistance to some of these different families. So like Brian said, we've got to go with everything that we've got with multiple modes of action pre and then post, sure. If we don't have any options except now we can use Dicamba or now we can use 2,4-D, all right, well, here we are, right back to one family trying to do all the work.
Yeah, but it should never be just one family trying to do all the work. You've got to rotate modes of action and use multiple modes of action. So for example, let's just say that this farmer that I talked to used Corvastel. That's fine. I don't have that big of an issue with that. But if you know, hey, we've got ALS resistance and I suspect HPPD resistance, why would you use that post-emerge? What I'd do is I'd throw some atrazine together with Status. So now I've got three different modes of action there. Status has difluphenazine here in it, and it's got a little bit of dicamba. So I've got atrazine, difluphenazine, dicamba. I got three different things that can all attack that water hemp, and I shouldn't have any resistance issues if all together then, between my pre and post, I used five modes of action. That's pretty good.
All right, but it's important to think about effective modes of action.
Yep.
So again, if you're using that pre-program and you say, well, hey, here's Corvus, that's got two modes of action, and I'm gonna mix something else with it. Now I got a third mode of action. That's fine, but the other two didn't even work at all on the pigweed. So now you've got one mode of action. Then you come back post with one mode of action. That better work,
all right,
or you're going to be in big trouble.
And here's the other thing. If you suspect you're having some issues, switch out of whatever you were using before. The first confirmed case of common ragweed resistance to Roundup in the state of South Dakota, the farmer found out that it was confirmed. Yep, absolutely. That's what it is. What do you think the farmer came back with the next year? Spraying just Roundup again. It's like, come on, use something different. We have lots of different modes of action available. The pricing on almost all herbicides has come down over the last few years. So there are good, inexpensive ways to go. Don't keep doing the same thing you've been doing if you've been having some problems.
The real question though now is, will any of these modes of action control our weed of the week? We'll show you what will stop it coming up next.
Weed of the Week is rough fleabane.
Oh, you might have thought our Weed of the Week was mare's tail, and this is the problem with this weed. There are several different types of fleabane, and when they're really small, they look a lot like mare's tail. And so guys think, man, I've got mare's tail, I've got to switch away from Roundup, and I'm going to try and use some other fancy concoction. When, hey, you know what? If I would just stick with the Roundup, it would help control the fleabane.
Yeah, but Darren, here's the other problem. It might be a summer annual, might be a winter annual, it might be a biennial. This is a weird weed. So you have to attack it when you see it, and that might be in the fall, it might be in the spring, we just don't know.
Well, regardless of when it's out there, you do need to be scouting your fields and finding these weeds when they're small. Once the fleabane gets big, it's very difficult to control. And really, honestly, there aren't tons of herbicide options for it. So depending on where you're at, if you're in a pasture, if you're out in cropland, well, Roundup may not be an option for you. So yeah, if you're in just a burn down and there's nothing else that you want to live, sure, Roundup can definitely be in the mix. But when you're talking about in grassland, for example, you may use something like 2,4-D. 2,4-D can do an effective job on the annual fleabanes. If it happens to be a biennial, you may want something else.
Well, in pasture ground, I might go with something like Tordon. In crop, well, Roundup is pretty effective, so I'm not too worried about it in Roundup Ready corn or soybeans, but certainly you could go with something pre-emerge. In soybeans, I like Sencor Down or Metribuzin. Valor's not too bad. In corn, not really that worried about it. Status post-emerge.
Well, you can add in your pre-emerge herbicides, Triple Flex or a Sure Start.
Yeah,
Hornet
true.
Is still pretty effective, but you've got to get it when it's real small.
Yep, and then in wheat, we'd probably do Sharpen Down followed with Husky post-emerge.
That's all time we have for this week's weed, but Iron Talk is coming up next.
There are trillions of hardworking microbes right beneath your feet. Today, Monsanto BioAg is harnessing the power of microbes, creating microscopic farmhands that help plants access nutrients, enhance root and shoot growth, and handle stressful conditions throughout the season, protecting and maximizing your yield potential. We're turning 500 trillion microbes into 500 trillion new farmhands, ready for work. Nature, it's powerful technology.
With the success of the Case IH Digger Quad Track and Magnum Road Track tractors, it's no secret why Case IH is the leader of the track. So it wasn't surprising when the competition started imitating us. But only Case IH offers a five-axle design to give you a smoother ride, more power to the ground, with less berming and compaction. Still, we're flattered. In fact, if we weren't already red, we'd be blushing.
farmer's attention to detail is what makes the difference. You take the time for service management because you know how vital it is to your operation. You service your field like everything else because soil sampling makes all the difference and gets the results you want. Download the app Soil Test Pro and start grit sampling today. Keep your farm growing strong. The more you test, the more you know.
I would recommend Morton for many reasons, but one is that they have a long history of standing behind their buildings.
Our sales experience with Morton was a nice experience. You know, they told us what it was going to cost, what it was going to be, you know, how it was going to run, and it worked out really well for us.
Morton has built me one heck of a nice building, and it should stand for a very, very long time. I was very happy with the workmanship.
Check us out online at mortonbuildings.com.
We've been dealing with AgriLiquid a little over 7 years. I was skeptical, to be honest, but I watched the results from several clients. Those results were increased production and reduction in input cost. With AgriLiquid, we saw an increase in the size of the initial root mass. For ranchers, that means forage production a lot quicker. AgriLiquid works. The bottom line is profitability.
Iron Talk is brought to you by Case IH.
The AFS Connect Farm Management System from Case IH connects you, and only you, to the information you need most from your equipment, from anywhere, at any time. AFS Connect, only from Case IH.
Could one of the least fun jobs on the farm actually be a $100 per hour job in disguise? I'm talking about spray tank cleanout. Now, we've talked about this earlier this spring, but we have just seen so many issues with this again this year, as many farmers are tank mixing things that they frankly haven't used before or haven't used in many years. You've been asking for help and some tips about cleaning things out right. So in today's Iron Talk, we'll discuss proper tank cleanout procedures. Now, if it's your farm and your sprayer, you'll certainly save yourself $100 an hour's worth of work here, and probably a whole lot more, by doing a great job cleaning out your spray tank when you're switching products. Here's a strategy to help with this challenge on your farm. First, each herbicide you spray may need a little different product to clean it out of the tank. So read the label and also ask your supplier what works best for the chemicals you're using. If you're tank mixing together a bunch of different things, it may take more than one different cleanout procedure to get this to work. Now, it could be a commercial tank cleaner. It could be household ammonia or bleach. Who knows what it's going to be? So you have to check into this with each of the products that you're spraying. I'll give you an example. A few years back, farmers were having trouble cleaning lotus out of their sprayers. Once we learned that bleach is highly effective at getting it out, the cleanup job got so much easier. Okay, the second thing you need to know is clean out that tank as soon as you're done spraying. We've seen a number of guys that have gotten into some tough weather conditions and they spray and then they leave things in the tank. And then it sticks, and it's very difficult to get it out. So make sure you're still cleaning the tank out when it's liquid. Finally, after rinsing out that tank once or twice, fill the tank up with water, and then put in the cleaning solution that you're using with it and charge the booms. Then let it sit overnight or all day and let the cleaner work. Rinse it out when you're done. Pay special attention to the sprayer sumps, pumps, screens, and strainers, as they often hide herbicide carryover from before. Also, make sure to check out all the places that contamination can hang up around spray tips and out at the end of the booms. Yeah, it's a lot of work to do this, but the benefits are fantastic. Peace of mind as you're spraying out your next batch without fear of damaging your crop. No neighbors giving you a hard time about a field with brown spots in it, and it's easily a $100 per hour job. That's all for today's Iron Talk, and now back to the show.
Closed captioning for Ag PhD is sponsored by Norwood Sales.
On your farm, you need speed and year-round effectiveness in your tillage program. The Quick Till from Norwood Sales allows you to move quickly through your fields, maximizing time and improving yield. Constructed of heavy-duty materials, the Quick Till is ideal for both spring and fall applications, from preparing a healthy seedbed early in the season to breaking up corn residue after harvest. For more information about how a quick till can improve fields on your farm, call Norwood Sales today.
That's all the time we have for today's show, but before we go, we want to invite you to tune into the Ag PhD radio show. You'll find us each weekday at 2 p.m. Central on Sirius XM channel 147, where we take your live phone calls.
Don't miss the next Ag PhD TV show. We'll have another Weed of the Week, Farm Basics, Iron Talk, and a whole lot more. I'm Darren Hefty.
And I'm Brian Hefty. Thanks for watching Ag PhD.
Soil is nature's filter to keep contaminants out of our water. To learn how farmers manage soil and groundwater, visit the Responsible Nutrient Management Foundation at rnmf.org.